John Deacon strikes it big. Another one bites the dust. Next on Crown Jewels. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Crown Jewels. I am your host, PLD, and this is the podcast where I take you on a journey throughout the entirety of Queen, song by song, version by version, figure out which version of each song is the best version or Crown Jewel version, give you some notes, some quotes, and we see if the song slides into my top 10 Queen-related tracks of all time. And this one, well, settle in, folks. This one might be a long one. Probably the longest episode we've had because there are just a lot of versions to take in. I'm talking about Another One Bites the Dust, written by John Deacon, featuring Freddie Mercury on lead and backing vocals, Brian May on guitars, John on bass guitar, rhythm guitar, and piano, and then Roger Taylor on the drums. So how many versions are we going to be listening to try to figure out which is the Crown Jewels? Well, I don't want to scare you guys off, but there are 41 versions. 41 versions. I'm going to pack them as tightly as I can. And a lot of them are kind of just remixes of a remix, or there's five different mixes, there's five different live versions. I'm going to pack it in as tight as I can. And you certainly don't have to listen to 41 versions of the song with me. If you want to, I'm more than happy to have you do so. But I know a lot of this, that will be time consuming. So I'll try to give you as best I can an overview on things. And we'll go from there. And if you wanted to skip some things, you know, I'll try to tell you where you can skip some things and where you can't. But let's dive into it. So Another One Bites the Dust is the third highest streamed song on Spotify by Queen, just behind Bohemian Rhapsody and Don't Stop Me Now. Another One Bites the Dust should be their third to hit 2 billion streams. Right now it is at 1.89 billion streams. So closing in at 1.9, and then after that, should be hitting 2, not too far. Of course, Bohemian Rhapsody at 2.5 billion streams right now. Also, big back in the day as well, one of their best-selling singles of all time. Hit number 1 in Argentina, Canada, Guatemala, Spain, and the United States. While hit number 2 in New Zealand, 3 in South Africa, 4 in Ireland and Finland, 5 in Australia, 6 in Austria and Germany, 7 in Belgium and the UK, 8 in Switzerland, 10 in Italy, 14 in the Netherlands, 24 in France, and 28 in Brazil. A very, very successful song indeed, especially considering how different it really is compared to a lot of the other Queen tracks before. And we'll get into that as we listen to it. A couple of quick notes and stories, and then some quotes. The story goes that Michael Jackson is the one who pushed the band to release it as a single, stating it would definitely be a smash. Roger Taylor specifically was not big on releasing it as a single. In fact, wasn't very big on the song at all in the beginning. He was eventually won over, as success will be wont to do. It was inspired, partially, the famous bass line was inspired by the Chic song, Good Times. Also, it was claimed that the chorus, when played in reverse, can be heard as, decide to smoke marijuana, or it's fun to smoke marijuana, or start to smoke marijuana. This was a trend back in the day. If you had never heard of this, lots of backward messages in the songs that, I don't know where people came up with this. I don't know how they decided this. I don't know who checked it to begin with. But the spokesperson for Queen and Hollywood Records that has denied any such message. The band has denied any such message. I personally think it's ridiculous, but hey, it is pretty fun. Hitting close to home as a public safety dispatcher who dispatches police, fire, and EMS, this is a song that's used by many people to train in CPR, as it has 110 beats per minute. The compressions are supposed to be 100 to 120. That's the recommended compressions. So I'm not sure if somebody should really be singing Another One Bites the Dust while performing CPR, but it does work musically for what you're trying to do. And lastly, before we get into some quotes, it's been covered many times and played live from the first tour all the way through the last tour. Brian and Roger never played it in their solo tours, but every Queen tour definitely saw Another One Bites the Dust make a strong appearance. So some quotes from Brian in 1993. John Deacon, being totally in his own world, came up with this thing which was nothing like we were doing. We were going for the big drum sound, you know, quite pompous in our usual way. And Deacon says, no, I want this to be totally different. It's going to be a very tight drum sound. It was originally done to a drum loop. This was before the days of drum machines. Roger did a loop, kind of under protest, because he didn't like the sound of the drums recorded that way. And then Deacon put this groove down. Immediately, Freddie became violently enthusiastic and said, this is big. This is important. I'm going to spend a lot of time on this. It was the beginning of something quite big for us, because it was the first time that one of our records crossed over to the black community. We had no control over that. It just happened. Suddenly, we were forced to put out this single because so many stations in New York were playing it. It changed that album from being a million seller to being a 3 million seller in a matter of 3 weeks or so. A quote from John Deacon from 1996, I've been wanting to do a track like Another One Bites the Dust for a while, but originally all I had was the line of the bass riff. Gradually I filled it in and the band added ideas. I could hear it as a song for dancing, but had no idea it would become as big as it did. The song got picked up off our album and some of the black radio stations in the US started playing it, which we've never had before. Michael Jackson actually suggested we release it as a single. He was a fan of ours and used to come to our shows. And lastly, I'll give you some reviews. Billboard called it a startling track with a spare, lean sound. Record World said it was a brutal bass conspiring with a sing-along hook on a thoroughly contagious song. While classic rock history critic Willie Zeller rated it John Deacon's second best Queen song. I did find those from Wikipedia, but hey, what can you do? It also garnered Queen their first American Music Award in January of 1981, and it was a Grammy nomination for Best Rock Performance by a Duo or Group with a Vocal, but unfortunately, it did not win the Grammy. All right, let's get into listening. I'm not going to name all the versions off the top of my head right now, because that's what I usually do, but with 41 versions, we'll just play this by ear. We're going to start with the studio version, the album version, of course, like we always do. So how do we do that? I can't get struck. I'm not going to do anything like that. So what I do, in the show notes, you'll find a link to a Google Doc, which will have all the links you could need to YouTube videos that are available for you to listen to before you... So you pause me, you go listen to the track, you come back, and then we will talk about it. First off, the album version from The Game for Another One Bites the Dust. Pause me, and I'll see you soon. Now, if you're listening to this podcast, I'm quite sure you've heard this song before. And if you haven't, well, welcome to the podcast. This is a very different type of song than Queen had played up until this point. Very sparse, very spared, not a whole lot of overdubs, not a whole lot of, you know, grand choirs, no guitar core orchestras. That bass starts right away. It's a very nice bass. Again, I mentioned, you know, it's inspired by Good Times, similar kind of feel. That's joined by Brian's guitar doubling it. And that drum loop is really tight. I know Roger doesn't like drum loops, but he uses it to a great degree of success here. Freddie's very aggressively vocal in this. You can tell how excited he is about singing this song. He commands this song. It's a very ripping through the vocals, ripping through the lyrics, and it's like very percussive almost. It's almost like a machine gun with how he's almost kind of rapping to a degree. Not quite, obviously, not quite. But it's like getting into that realm. I love when the second verse goes up the octave and he starts really making his vocal cords bleed as he gets that really ripped feel in his voice. Very aggressive, very powerful, wonderful. It's interesting to note there are no synthesizers in the song, despite this being the first full album with synthesizers. All the effects were created by piano, electric guitars, and drums, with some tape playback performed in reverse at some various speeds. Had some harmonizers, of course, and the swirling nature of the beginning part of that can be part of right before the first lyric. I mean, that's also part of the harmonizing. Brian does get a nice guitar bit going. John's rhythm playing is wonderful in this. It's got a really funky feel. John doesn't get to play guitar too often, but he definitely has a strong turn here. This is a great song. It's a dancey song. It definitely gets you moving. The only drawback for me personally is because I've heard it so many times that it's hard for me to hear new things when I listen to it. This is one of those songs where, again, like I said, over almost 2 billion streams. It's been played on radio stations all over the place. It's one of those tracks that still gets played on classic rock today. So some of those songs can kind of, like, you know, hit me in the chest and bounce right off me like I got a bulletproof vest on. I'd like to dive a little deeper into some of their lesser heard stuff. But that doesn't change the fact that this was a very successful song for a reason. Very crisp, very tight, very short and sweet, and it delivered a wonderful number one for the band. All right, let's get to the next version. I will tell you right now, you don't really need to listen to this one. If you want to, this is where you would pause it and go check it out. But we'll talk about it when you get back. But if we have time constraints, this is definitely one that you can skip. There you have it, the Columbia extended version that appeared on the Columbia Another One Bites the Dust 12-inch vinyl. It's basically just a song, and if you heard that little clip I played, it just kind of has, towards the end of the song, before it ends, it kind of all of a sudden just like kind of quickly stops and starts the song again, and then it goes all the way through from the beginning. So really, it's nothing different. It's just kind of like putting the song back to back. Pretty much it's putting it on loop. It just kind of cuts into the end just a little bit. That's it. That's all there is to it. So let's just move on to the next one. The next one we're going to talk about, the Dave Ogilvy Alternative Mix. It was released on a Hollywood Records, which was the U.S. Queen label in 1991. They released something called the Freak Show Sampler, and it was a bunch of different remixes of different songs, including a Queen track. All remixes of bands, songs that were on that label at the time. And Dave Ogilvy is a producer, remixer. He has worked with Skinny Puppy, Marilyn Manson, and he released this remix of Another One Bites the Dust. So click on that link below and come back, and we will talk about it.
Hey, 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 I'm gonna go. Let's go.
All right, this is the first of a lot of different dance style remixes we're going to listen to. This one is one of the more interesting ones in my eyes. I wouldn't say it's awesome or amazing, but it's got some interesting bits to it compared to some of the other ones, which kind of just drone on a little bit. I love the Freddy intro with all the different Freddys, you know, just doing the little riffs from the song or behind it, maybe some additional tracks that we don't have, or maybe they're buried in the mix. I'm not certain. There's a long intro after that, though, with a lot of noise and this deeper rhythm before Freddy just comes in doing the chorus vocals over and over again through the record scratch, and there's like the effects on his voice. But honestly, it's a long enough intro because the first verse doesn't come in until about a minute and a half, a minute 40 into it. We do have some samples throughout. Bohemian Rhapsody was sampled in the background at one point, and then it comes in again more obviously towards the middle. And that actually is the part I said didn't work for me, because it all of a sudden slows it down and kind of like brings the momentum to a little bit of a halt. It doesn't really fit very well. It's interesting, but I don't think it works. The previous ones, the smaller ones that are just kind of in the background, those do work. I do think the rhythm guitar gets a little bump up in this mix, so that's kind of cool. And then the ending, it just kind of just extends on for a little bit too long, kind of overstays its welcome a little bit. The bass riff goes on, other things get piled on top with some editing. The ending Freddy line, again, is great, hearing that little thing you hear a cappella, which you don't get to hear very often. So it's a little bit of a mixed bag, but mixed positive for me. If I'm going to listen to some of the dancier remixes, which is not really generally my cup of tea, I want to listen to the main track or the live versions, perhaps. But this is one of those remixes which I won't probably turn off. If it comes on, I'm like, okay, I can get through it. There's some cool moments in there, especially with the additional Freddy vocals that I don't get to hear very often, so that's why, go for it. All right, let's move on to the next one. This one is the Phase 5 version. There's two of them, Phase 5 long dusted b-boy version and then Phase 5 short version. I'm going to have you listen to both of those tracks before we come back. These featured on another Hollywood track called Basic Beat Sampler Promo. It was actually issued initially to promote a forthcoming but yet ultimately unreleased collection of remixes called Queen the Basic Bootlegs. These are two versions, the long dusted b-boy version, which is over 10 minutes, and then there's the short version at 4 minutes and 19 seconds. It does feature Raw Fusion. I don't know who they are or what that's going on, but hey, listen to those two tracks if you want. Or just listen to the shorter version. You'll get most of what you need. And then come back and I'll talk about it. Okay, so that was something. It's very long. The long version, very long and pretty weird. A lot of samples are used, and sometimes it doesn't even really use the song as a basis. We do hear a little bit of Flash Gordon in the beginning, which is something we're going to get to eventually. The bass line doesn't come in until about a minute in. It's a really tight loop at some time, but then it just kind of goes off into these weird territories. The short version, I would say it's the same feel as the long one, but with 6 minutes less, that kind of makes it better. But yeah, not my cup of tea, but if you're interested in it, good for you. Go for it. That's all we're going to... I don't really have much more to say about that. It's just... It's not... not my cup of tea, and it kind of goes in these just weird directions with all those samples all over the place. It's hard to even like really qualify it as a remix of the song. It's just like almost like they took the bass line and decided to just add a bunch of stuff to it and call it a day. Hey, but hey, what do I know? I don't do these remixes. I don't do these dancing remixes for sure. Maybe you like it. Who knows? All right, next up, the Chiz Kills remix, which features Ice Cube, Hi-C, and Chiz Kills, and also appeared on this Basic Queen bootleg, which is a promo CD that was never officially released. Yeah, let's listen to that, and we'll talk about it for sure.
Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust.
Okay, I don't really know what that is, to be honest with you, besides people kind of screaming Another One Bites the Dust. I could really hardly pick out anything from the original song at all. I couldn't even tell you if there was anything in there. Basically, it was almost like an original song that had some of the, maybe some samples thrown in there. I mean, I don't know why it's a remix. It'd actually be another song. It's not a remix of that. It's really its own song with the same title. And yeah, I don't know. It's not, definitely not my cup of tea at all. But as far as, you know what, I should take that back. That's not really my comment on the song. It's my comment on being a remix of the Queen song. It's just so wildly different. As a rap song, it's not bad. It's fine. But it's not, if I'm looking for Another One Bites the Dust remix, I'm not going to look for this one because it's not really remixing the song. All right. Hey, what can you do? All right, now we're going to get into a version, a bunch of versions actually now. A Queen did a version with Wyclef Jean, the famous Wyclef Jean in 1998 for Small Soldiers, and we're going to have a bunch of them to listen to. So you're going to want to listen to all of them because I'm going to discuss all of them. We have the original one, we have the radio edit, we have the a cappella version, we have the instrumental version, we have the Small Soldiers video mix, we have the Team One Black Rockstar main pass mix, we have the Team One Black Rockstar radio edit, the Team One Black Rockstar instrumental. Now, unfortunately, a lot of the versions don't have YouTube links to them, so you're not going to be able to listen to those. If you listen to the main version, that'll probably get you everything you need for the most part. I wish that the Team One Black Rockstar main pass mix was on it, because it is a little bit different than the other versions, and that's another like subsection of the remix. But yeah, let's listen to that, and we will go from there.
And another one, Wyclef, and another one, Dirty Cash, another one, Young Free, Freddie, where you at?
Brooks, spread it down the street.
Okay, so that one at least sounds a lot more familiar, right? It does feature like Wyclef Jean of Fugees and Praz and Free. This version actually featured on Greatest Hits 3, Queen Plus Greatest Hits 3, because it was a single. It was also on the soundtrack I mentioned of the movie Small Soldiers. Basically, it takes the original bass riff, and Wyclef, Free, and Praz will rap over that, and then Freddie will sing the choruses, and Freddie will sing some verses. Wyclef actually shouts out Freddie, and Freddie gets shouted out at the beginning, and then towards the end as well. A couple times, actually, throughout. It's a fun version, I'm not going to lie. It's kind of a nice, bouncy version. It does use the version, the No One Bites the Dust, as the basis far more than the previous couple of remixes did. So this is pretty fun stuff. I don't mind this one at all. In fact, if you like Wyclef and you like Queen, which might be an interesting combination for some people, but if you do, this is a perfect mix for you. To move on to some of the other ones, the 1998 radio edit basically just fades out 20 seconds early, followed up by the a cappella version. And the instrumental version, just exactly as they sound out, the a cappella version has no instrumentation, just Wyclef, Freddie, Praz, and Free, with some added spoken parts at the beginning, which do feature later on in the Team One Black Rockstar version. It's kind of interesting. I kind of like that. I like it better than the instrumental version. The instrumental version is fine. It's fine. But the instrumental version just kind of... It shows the extra effects and stuff that Wyclef and Queen put on top of it. But I like my stuff with vocals at this point specifically, because I don't, for a hip hop kind of remix, the instrumental version doesn't do it for me. I prefer hearing the vocals and the stuff together. So the Small Soldiers video mix is basically just an early fade out of the LP version, the main version. So that's just that. Next, let's get to the Team One Black Rockstar mixes. A couple of them. We have the main pass, the radio edit, and the instrumental. Okay, now these, honestly, Without spoiling my rankings I'm going to do later on, this is the best of the Y Club genre mixes so far. The backing track of the original song has been maintained a little bit more, the bass riff being looped. It does start off with this intro by Y Club. This is the one that you heard from the a cappella version, with him wondering if he could be a rock star. The same Y Club Freddy parts that were in the original version are there. There's a little more guitar added to it, and I think more of the original song is actually maintained. So I actually prefer these two, the original version or the soundtrack version. I will say the radio edit is pretty much an effective, right to the point edit of the main pass mix. It looks a little better than the full version because there's just less filler to it. Some interesting string-like synths in the middle there that are not available, I believe, in the main pass mix. Kind of felt like there was a different middle, or maybe they were just turned up more. I don't know. It's interesting. The Black Rockstar instrumental, you can hear even more of the original in here amped up, and the additions in there are quite nice. So I do actually like this instrumental version a little bit better because you can hear more of the original song thrown in there. So it's much more of a true rock song instrumental, not as much of the remix stuff added in. So... and that wraps it up for the Wyclef version of the Queen plus Wyclef genre. Moving on now to Queen plus Annie Crummer. Annie Crummer is a New Zealand pop star who played the character of Killer Queen in the Australian production of We Will Rock You the Musical. So in 2003, they released a remix of Another One Bites the Dust again with Annie on vocals. And they also did a little bit of different adding synth stuff and adding some different beats in there. They even added some different vocal sections as well. It's an interesting take. There's two versions. There's the main version and then there's the instrumental version. Unfortunately, we don't have YouTube versions here. So unfortunately, we won't be able to hear them. But you can listen to the little snippet I'll play and then I'll come back and I'll talk about it. So if you do ever find a way to track it down, I think it's worth a listen. It does start with that interesting like Knight Rider kind of synth beat soundtrack there that you got to hear in the snippet there. It was remixed actually by Josh McCray and by Roger Taylor. Josh McCray, you'll find out to be the drummer of Roger's side band, The Cross, and then after The Cross disbanded, Josh kind of stuck around as a producer and mixer and engineer for Roger Taylor's solo stuff, and through some of the Queen stuff as well. It's definitely pretty faithful overall with some effects added to it, like that synth beat exactly. There's some vocal bits that are added by Annie. There's definitely one section where there's this vocal run, which actually sounds a little bit like Britney Spears. Annie does a rip at the vocals at the end. She's actually very aggressive with it, and I do like that. She plays it kind of slinky at first, but then it really gets into it. She gets into it. And the instrumental, not completely instrumental. I do have those Britney vibe na-na-nas in there as well, but it's interesting hearing the different effects that Roger and Josh put on it in addition to the song. So overall, pretty solid. It doesn't stray very far. It's just not like those dance remixes. It's just an actual interesting remix of basically a pop remix that was done in the 2000s, early 2000s, compared to the 1980 version. All right, next up, in 2006, there was a release of a couple different singles, Queen versus the Miami Project, all remixes of Another One Bites the Dust. We have a couple different ones to listen to, the Cedric Gervais and Second Son radio edit, the Cedric Gervais and Second Son vocal mix, also known as the dub mix. There's the Cedric Gervais and Second Son club mix. There is the Oliver Koletsky remix. There's the A Skills remix. There is the Soul Avengers remix, the Soul Avengers dub, and finally DJ Pedro and Oliver Berger remix. These are all released on various singles. You can listen to one of them if you'd like. I'd maybe want to listen to one of each of the kind of things. Only one of the Cedric Gervais's, maybe the Oliver Koletsky one, DJ Pedro. Maybe do what you want to do. It's either way. You can listen to just the little snippet I'm going to tell you about. Maybe if you're a purist, you probably don't want to get into that many remixes. I understand that. I understand. I did it for you. So let's listen to them and we'll come back and talk about it. So all these versions were spread out over various formatted releases. We'll start with the Cedric Gervais and Second Son radio edit. Definitely sped up. It's definitely amped up. It's definitely a dance club remix. That's all I'll say there. The whole song is there. There's some added percussive keys. There's some occasional effects. But there's that drum beat that speeds up the tempo quite a bit. If you love dance songs or dance clubs, this could be absolutely for you. The vocal mix or the dub mix just adds a long intro and an outro into the song, and some other effects are tossed in now and then. But it's pretty much the same version overall, just like, again, extended at the beginning, extended at the end. The Second Son Club Mix is pretty much an instrumental version of the vocal mix, just without the vocals. A few samples thrown in here and there, alongside a few more effects. The Oliver Kolesky remix is slower than the rest of the Miami Project mixes, which I do appreciate to a degree. A lot of echoes on the vocals. There's this kind of spacey, sci-fi feel to it. Kind of almost like reminds me of David Bowie in space, Flight of the Conchords, to a degree, that same kind of tone a little bit. As far as the vocals go, and as far as some of the effects go, I should say. Not at all like the song itself. Please, I'm not that out of there. It's not bad, but it does get a little bit repetitive towards the end, especially at the end. Next up, the A Skills remix is somewhat interesting. There's some definitely rhythm changes that are a bit unsettling. They kind of all of a sudden, like, it just stops and almost stops momentum, and then it kind of, like, restarts. But I will say the changes kind of keep it from getting too repetitive like some of the other mixes do. There's also some additional guitar work in the middle, which is actually kind of cool. This one maybe, I'll see in a minute, but this one might be my favorite of the Miami Project remixes for sure. The Soul Avengers remix. My notes are kind of getting shorter and shorter on these because I got to be honest, after listening to a bunch of these in the row, they all really start flowing together. Long, all I wrote really was long and repetitive. It just doesn't go too far for me. Same with the Avengers dub. It's similar, but feels even more repetitive with the sample guitar and chorus just set to the back dance backbeat. Yeah, I guess it works for a club setting probably. If you're sweaty, you're dancing, that's what it's there for. But if you're just sitting home listening to it on your headphones, and I don't think it has the same effect, and maybe it shouldn't have the same effect. And I'm sure some people out there would love that and love dancing to it in a sweaty club. More power to you. Finally got the DJ Pager and Oliver Berger remix. Got some more video game like sound effects at times. But basically, it's just the bass line over and over and over again, with occasionally Freddie singing another one, Bites of Dust. So, repetitiveness to the extreme. But here we go, folks. That's it for the studio versions. Now we can get into the rest of the version, which are all the different live versions we have heard over the years. That's right, all the different live versions. We will first start talking about the Freddie era, the Queen Freddie era, where we have official releases for Rocks Montreal, On Fire at the Bowl, Live Magic, Live at Wembley times 2, and Hungarian Rhapsody. So go listen to one more, as many as you want. Come back, we'll talk about the Freddie era of Queen during another One Bites of Dust. I will admit that one drawback of this is when I record this podcast, I am listening to all these tracks and I'm listening to them back to back to back to back. And especially, you know, I just listen to a lot of different studio versions. There are a lot of live versions here as well. So they do start to roll into each other. So you might hear me get a little bit sparse about them. But I'm going to try to break them down as best as I can and find the best versions of them. And we'll go from there. The first up one were Rocks Montreal from probably my favorite Queen live album, Greatest Set, Greatest Sound. This Another One Bites the Dust feels like a much heavier version than the album, which is something you're going to find to be true, especially for the Hot Space album, when they have a more rocking version live than the more dancier studio version. Brian's guitar is definitely a bit more up in the mix. Roger sings the chorus along with the crowd, allowing Freddie to kind of rest his vocal cords a little bit during that. I like hearing Roger sing. You know how much I love Roger's voice, so that might be my own personal thing. I like hearing Roger get a chance to shine on the chorus, though. But it works well. It does work well. The breakdown has a few ad-libs in there, which work very well. And Brian has some nice dabs after the breakdown, which are very nice. The band sounds tight. The band allows itself to improv a little bit, just enough. It's a little bit longer, a little more of a jam out to it. I like this version a lot. Next up, we have the On Fire at the Bowl, which is live at Milton Keynes in 1982. I really think this is a John version, a really great John version. He's got a very fluid bass line in this that just stands out. I think Brian's guitar is a little bit more down on the mix on this one, but he ad-libs a lot. Like during the breakdown, you get a little bit more of that bass breakdown from John, which is really kind of cool. Freddie's more actively singing the chorus than Roger this time, so it's Freddie and Roger together. It's a great get on down bit breakdown from Freddie, where he just starts to get on down, kind of goes off into this different area, which is really kind of cool. It's a very solid, solid version, and you know what? Good for John standing out on his own song. I like that. All right, next up we got Live Magic. Live Magic, of course, was a kind of a bastardized album. It was released after the 1986 tour, but it was a single album, and it contained a lot of edits. So it's really kind of shitty because you don't want to hear Queen songs edited. Like, whole verses are taking out trying to make the whole thing fit. They skip. It's live at Wembley is such, and Hungarian Rhapsody both are much better packages to listen to the Magic tour. However, this is actually from Live Magic, and this is actually a very cool version. It is a full version. This is also from Nebworth. This is recorded in Nebworth. That's the best thing about Live Magic, is you get some audio from the very last Queen concert of all time, the Freddie era of Queen. It's a ton of fun and ad-libs throughout. The mix isn't the greatest. This album has never been mixed very great, but there is some very blistering Brian work in this one. Probably Brian's best guitar work that we've seen so far. Some great ad-libs in the breakdown. And it's just kind of cool hearing Freddie do it one last time. It's kind of got that little bit of nostalgia in there. You're like, oh, this is it. But it's one of the most fun mixes. One of the most fun versions, I should say. I wish the mix was a little bit more up to Rocks Montreal and On Fire at the Bull. Next up, we have Live at Wembley. Of course, both days were taped. We do have the first one from July 11th. Roger seems a little less gravelly in his vocals for some reason. I don't know if that's a mix thing or if that's maybe because of the rain coming down. I don't know what effect that would have, but he feels a little less gravelly. Brian does some great guitar work in the breakdown, for sure. John has some nice ad-libs in this one as well, although he kind of feels he's a little bit down in that mix. Freddie's pretty aggressive on this one. He's pretty ripping straightforward on this one. Whereas July 12th, the next day, I think it's everything about day one, but it's even better, including a better mix for John. This is the one that was actually released. July 11th was released as a bonus version on the DVD release. The actual album version from Live at Wembley featured the July 12th version. And I like starting off with Roger's drum count. It's a kind of a cool mix, kind of a cool version. I do like that one quite a bit. Finally, Hungarian Rhapsody. This is the fourth Magic Tour one I'm listening to. And this is actually, again, good mix, but much like the Wembley days, this one, the Hungarian Rhapsody one, was fine. Didn't do a whole lot to stand out and really notice anything specifically. Like, oh, we could point that out. Oh, we could point that out. It's not a bad version. Pretty tight, pretty good sounding. But overall, I'm going to choose other ones to be the highlighted version for sure. That's all the Queen versions I listened to. Next up, we got to go forward to the Queen plus Paul Rodgers era. Got the Return of the Champions version. We have Live in Birmingham from 2005 from the Downloads. Super Live in Japan, which is the end of the 2005 tour. Live in Ukraine 2008. And then the Queen and Paul Rodgers Downloads from that tour, which are Berlin, Mannheim, Madrid, and Vienna. So a lot of Queen and Paul Rodgers versions to listen to. And they're all going to run together. I'm not going to lie. But I'll try to pick apart some of the better things that make it stand out from the other ones. Let's go listen to that, and we'll come back, pick out one of them. I'd say at least listen to maybe one from each tour, from one from the 2005, one from 2008. Your minds may vary. Come back, and I'll talk about it. Yeah, yeah. Woo! All right, there you have it. This is something that's much more in Paul's wheelhouse than some other tracks, which is kind of strange to think about the disco versions of this being a disco type song. Again, live though, they definitely make it a little more rock. There's definitely some more hard crunchiness right in the beginning, especially talking about the Return of the Champions version. There's not as much ad-libs in the breakdown, but Brian does get a bit adventurous in this one, especially after the breakdown. But Paul really sings it well. He's got a very aggressive style that fits this pretty perfectly. They don't do a pop version. It's much more of a rock type version, especially because the Queen and Paul Rodgers band had more of a band than Queen did, and actually more of a band than Queen and Adam Lambert did. The Queen and Paul Rodgers band had, of course, Brian and Roger. They had a bassist, Danny Miranda, for Queen and Paul Rodgers. They had additional percussion by Rodgers' son, Rufus Tiger Taylor. We had Spike Edney, of course, on keyboards. And Jamie Moses played as a second guitarist in the Queen and Paul Rodgers era. So it has definitely a fuller version, which does allow Brian to get a little adventurous, if you like that. The other 2005 tours, live in Birmingham. I liked this mix better than the Return of the Champions, for sure. I think Paul gets a little more adventurous, having a lot of fun in it. And the breakdown is a lot of fun, even if it's a bit shorter than some of the other ones, potentially. Also, some good stuff from Brian again. Again, Brian getting the freedom to kind of be adventurous, since he has Jamie Moses to play the bassist part of it. It works very well. Super Live in Japan is from a specifically Japan-only release. And Paul Paul really shines in this version. This might be my favorite of the Paul versions. He takes some liberties with the melody. He takes some liberties with the choruses here and there. And does his own thing. And I really, really enjoyed Paul in this. The band's tight. Nothing specifically about them shines out in this version. This is definitely Paul's version to listen to. If you want to listen to Paul Rodgers, do it. In 2008, we got the Live in Ukraine 2008. This one, I put not Paul's best. I can't point out necessarily why. I feel like he kind of doesn't give it as much punch as he did in 2005 for this one, at least this version of it. Again, this is in front of a lot of people. This is a big, big audience for sure, live in Kiev. I will say Spike adds a little bit more ambience in this version, or at least if he did have the ambience in 2005, 2006, it sounded bigger in the mix in the 2008, at least live in Ukraine. For Berlin, it did sound much like Ukraine, but a bit more playful from Paul. Paul kind of rebounds here. I like this version from Paul. The ambience feels even louder in the mix, but it's a nice ambience. I actually like the way it feels. It definitely adds a little more to that live version. The crowd is kind of electric in this one. I do appreciate that. Mannheim in 2008. This one felt a little plodding, and I'm not going to blame Paul, because Paul feels game, but it just the band just doesn't gel as well as some of their performances I've heard. Nothing really points out, no mistakes, but it just doesn't feel as like tight and like moving as one as Queen usually does. It's not awful, but it definitely feels a little bit plodding. I think maybe they were a little tired for this one. Madrid, however, the next one, actually I felt the band was really energetic in this one. Paul and the band were really together on this one and moving as one like they usually do. A very powerful version for sure. Vienna, that's an aggressively playful Paul for this one. He takes his shine on this one, just like Super Live in Japan did. He really adds a lot of oomph to this one, making up for maybe Ukraine, making up for some of the other plotting efforts. This is really a fun one. The mix isn't the best, but Roger's a bit up for this one, so I like anything you have a little bit more Roger in there. I can't argue that. But that is the Queen and Paul Rodgers versions. So we're going to end that. The next one we're going to listen to, we do have Live Around the World, which is the Queen and Adam Lambert version of it. Listen to that. Come back and we'll talk about how he fits in. Are you ready? Hey, are you ready for this? You're hanging on the edge of your seat. Out of the doorway, bullets. Okay, interestingly enough, the tempo felt a smidge up from Queen and Paul Rodgers. Not what I expected, because the band, getting older, they tended to slow things down a little bit here and there. But this one felt a little more higher at this point. Rodgers' vocals are very much more clear in this version than any of the other Paul Rodgers versions, so I appreciate that, of course. But, of course, the big question is Adam. Adam, like I've always said, I've said many times before, and I'll probably say it many times again, I think he's a great balladeer, and he has a great pop singer. He sometimes struggled with rock. This being a pop song, I would expect him to really take it. It's not bad, but like the live version is a lot more rockier than the studio version, and so they're trying to do it more like the rock version, but it's not quite there. When he slinks and becomes slinky and sensual, which he does a few times, it's good. It's really good and really kind of fits that groove. But occasionally he tries to get, you know, badass, and it comes, you know, a bit more of that scrappy do, like I mentioned before, where he's like, this is not very intimidating as a singer. I don't feel that kind of aggressiveness from him. But it's definitely not bad, and I like hearing him do this live. He definitely has those good moments, and I think they should have just kind of maybe geared it more towards his slower down style. Like he did Dragon Attack, for example. That worked for him because of what he was trying to do with it. The slinkier side of things, for sure. But not bad. Not bad. All right, we got two alternative listens. They were not really officially released, but they are very interesting enough to put into this podcast, even with all the other versions we've listened to. First one we're going to listen to is Live in Calgary Park from 1993. Queen and Paul Young doing it. This is not the Paul Young that was at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert. This is a different Paul Young. So listen to that one, and we'll come back, and we will talk about it. Okay, this is Paul Young, not from Every Time You Go Away, the one that was at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert singing Radio Gaga. This is from Paul Young, who sings with the Mike and the Mechanics. And he also sang a lot with Spike Edney's All-Star Band, which I don't know if I've mentioned before, but Spike Edney, keyboardist and musical director for Queen now, and has been there since the 1984 tours. He has his own Spike's All-Star Band, which is a lot of cool musicians who come together, and they do a lot of covers and charity events, and Roger will pop in now and then, and Brian will pop in now and then. But it's really cool stuff that happens with them, for sure. This is That Paul Young. But that's not the real story here. The real story here, this is one of the most interesting concerts that Queen is technically a part of, because this is a Queen concert where Roger and John were billed as Queen. Brian was not there. There was no Brian. Of course, this is in 1993, so Freddie Mercury had passed away. There was a time after the Freddie Mercury tribute concert where Brian and Roger were a little not on the same page. Brian kind of wanted to move past Queen. Roger kind of wanted to get right to work on Made in Heaven to finish out Freddie's last wishes of releasing the last tracks he was recording. Brian needed a break, kind of. And they kind of had a little bit of a strained relationship at this point. And at one point, Roger said he wanted to continue maybe doing stuff live, and that maybe he even suggested once in an interview that I heard that they would maybe move on without Brian. And that would have been disastrous, I think, overall. For a one-off like this, probably shouldn't have been billed as Queen. But hey, if Brian and Roger can do it, then Roger and John can do it for a little bit of a time. On the band itself, Roger plays drums and vocals. He does guitar. John plays bass. We have Josh McCray, who also plays drums while Roger goes to the front. Jason Falloon, who plays guitar. He actually is on Roger Taylor's next solo album from 1994. Adrian Milne played keyboards for them. Not Spike Edney, surprisingly. I believe Spike Edney was busy during that particular concert. Interestingly enough, Roger and John would start working on Made in Heaven without Brian. And when Brian heard what they did, that's what kind of drew him back into the fold and said, no, we have to do it this way. And of course, the big fisticuffs would begin over that, which led to the Made in Heaven album. But let's get back to this. This version, of course, I like the version, but of course it's the bootleg, so it's just a horrible mix. It's not very good, easily to listen to, which is why I really wouldn't be able to. I do love Raj in this one. He's really trying his best. He's a force in this one. His drum breakdowns are great. He has a couple of different versions here. They are really fun. I don't know if Josh is playing with him during this, or maybe they're both playing drums. I don't know how the setup was. I didn't see a video of it. But it's really kind of cool hearing the additional drum work that Roger does. Vocals are fine. Paul Young is a fine singer. I'm not going to lie. I think it's a little bit forgettable overall, but perhaps that's partially because of the mix. However, because of the interesting story behind it, I figured it was a good chance for you to listen to it. And, you know, we'll see how it does in the rankings. Finally, we are down to the last one we're going to listen to, the final version we are going to listen to before we get into the rankings and ratings and all that good jazz. Live in Amsterdam in 2002, Queen with Meatloaf singer Patty Russo, female singer that sang with Meatloaf on I'd Lie for You and That's the Truth. And she sang with the Neverland Express, which is Meatloaf's band, for quite a few years. Queen, this is another interesting concert for them. This was a concert where the band hadn't done anything really for a while. They had a couple of one-offs here, mostly like quick ones with Five or, you know, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame type of stuff. This was actually a full-fledged concert that was not even announced. It was celebrating the Dutch Queen's birthday, and Brian and Roger actually do kind of a full set. It's definitely not a full, it's a back part of a festival, so it's a festival set. But they do a great job, and it was fun to see them back together. So listen to that version, and we will talk about it.
How do you think I'm gonna get along without you when you're gone? You took me for everything that I had and kicked me out of my own.
And there you have it. It's a little slow for me. This version is a little bit slow for me, but it's a fun version. Patty is great. The first verse is a little bit low for her. Makes it hard to hear. Once it goes to that second verse and beyond, she rocks the hell out of it. More credit to her. I would love to see Patty doing some more Queen stuff. She's actually a very big Queen fan. She's performed with them on a couple occasions, and even on her tour, she covered It's a Beautiful Day from Made in Heaven, which I don't know if anybody has covered, but also did Don't Stop Me Now. She's a great singer. She has a great time. You can tell the band's enjoying themselves. At one point during this track, if you watch the video, Brian steps back and stumbles into one of the amps, and him and Jamie Moses are laughing so hard they have a hard time getting back in sync for a second. You're like, it's a fun moment for sure. The band has a great time. She's having a great time. It's a very good version. I wish the tempo was a little bit faster, but good for Patty. I really think she was really aggressively getting into that one for sure. So yeah, there it is. That we did. We did it. We listened to everything. We listened to every version that we were going to listen to. Hallelujah. Let's move on and let's get into this. We're going to start ranking the crown jewel versions before we rate the track and see if it fits into my top 10 Queen-related tracks of all time. Crown jewel versions, I'm not going to beat around the bush. I'm just going to name it and try to talk about it a little bit if I need to. Least favorite of the whole thing, Phase 5 Long Dusted. The one that's weird and goes all over the place. I would almost put the Shizkill remix there because it's not even a Queen remix, but at least Phase 5 Long Dusted is 10 minutes long, almost 10, like 8 minutes longer. It's just, it's not worth it. So the next up from there is the Shizkill's remix because, quite frankly, it's not really a remix. It's an original song. Again, I'm not really judging the song. I'm judging the song as a remix to Another One Bites the Dust. From there, the Phase 5 short version, just because it's shorter doesn't mean it's any good. But it is better than the 10-minute version for sure. From there, we got the Queen vs. Miami Project Soul Avengers dub, then the Soul Avengers remix, then the Cedric Gervais and Second Sun Club remix. Above that, we have the Queen and Wyclef instrumental. Again, don't need the instrumental for that kind of thing, to be honest with you. Up there, and from that, Queen vs. Miami Project, DJ Pedro and Oliver Berger remix. Up above that, we have the Colombian 12-inch version. I almost feel bad putting it so low, but again, it's not its fault, but I'm never going to play it because it's just I'll just put the song on loop if I want to listen to it twice. I'd actually might listen to some of the remixes before I listen to them, but it is saying that I'd actually listen to this over the ones I've already talked about, so that says something. All right, from up there, Queen and Wyclef a cappella. We got the Queen and Miami Project Cedric Gervais and the Second Son vocal mix. The Queen and Wyclef radio edit, the Queen and Wyclef LP version, Queen and Wyclef Small Soldiers version, which I think works a little bit better. Gotta tell you, after all these, naming these off all in a row, and it's just part of it's because they are all batched together, because if I like one version, I like it by most of those versions. You're going to find, spoiler alert, I got all the studio mixes down, then all the live versions, and then the album versions up there, and the other parts, so stay tuned. Let's move on there. Next up from the After the Small Soldiers version, Queen vs. Miami Project, the Oliver Koletsky remix. The Dave Ogilvy remix slides in here. Queen and Miami Project, Cedric Gervais, and Second Son Radio Edit. That's the main version for that. Queen and Annie Crummer instrumental goes here, followed by Queen and Miami Project, a Skills remix, with all the interesting asides and that extra kind of cool guitar work in the middle from there. From there, we got the Queen and Wyclef Team One Black Rockstar main pass mix, the instrumental version, and then the radio edit. The main pass mix, just a little long. The other two are a little bit better, a little more crisper, a little more tight. From there, Queen and Annie Crummer. This is my favorite of the remixes because it stays close enough to the original. You don't want to stay too close to the original, but you also don't want to go too far out of the loop, which some of the other ones definitely do. This is a good solid way to do it. A lot of the main stuff still there, but enough to make it interesting for sure. All right, from there we're going to get into the rest. This is the Live in Cowjay Park 1993. We'd go there, and truth, would I put that actually below some of the remixes? Maybe, especially because of the mix of sound or the mix of the bootleg. But I'm giving Roger a little more credit here, and I do like to hear that, so that makes me happy to hear. So that's why I'm going to put that there. From there, Queen and Paul Rogers live in Mannheim in 2008, live in Ukraine 2008, live in Berlin 2008, live in Madrid 2008, then the Return of the Champions from 2005, live in Vienna from 2008, live in Amsterdam in 2002 with Patty Russo slides in here between some of the Paul Rogers era stuff. Live in Madrid 2008. Super Live in Japan from the end of the 2005 tour. Live in Birmingham 2005. I do like the 2005 tour versions better than the 2008 versions. After Birmingham 2005, we got Live Around the World, the Adam Lambert version. Yes, I actually do like the Adam Lambert version a little bit better than the Paul Rogers version. I think it's, even though it's in Paul's wheelhouse and Adam isn't quite there, the band feels a little bit more tight and there's a little more Roger in there. So, you know, I'm a Roger guy. What do you want to say? From there, this is where I slide the album version in. That's right. definitely going to go with a live version for sure, because the album version, it's not too disco for me, but I prefer the more aggressive rock and roll versions that Freddie and Queen played live. So there it becomes, which one is it? Hungarian Rhapsody is up from there, then Live Magic, Rocks Montreal, surprisingly a little low. Live at Wembley, day number one. Live at Wembley, day number two. Which means, if you've paid attention, can you figure it out? Can you figure out, after all the ones I've named, which one is my favorite and this week's crown jewel? On Fire at the Bowl, live at Milton Keynes, 1982. That is my crown jewel of Another One Bites the Dust. All right, let's move on to rating the song on a scale of 1 to 11, because we always turn things up to 11 here on PLD Projects. Another One Bites the Dust, I struggle with this. I'm going to give it an 8.5. I almost wanted to give it a little lower, but I admit wholeheartedly that's because I am a little overplayed by it. So one of the Queen songs I've heard so many times. I generally tend not to listen to it. I generally sometimes will skip it. It doesn't mean it's bad. If it comes on the radio, I'll still sing along to it. I still enjoy it. And it's very well done, especially as an effort that's very far away from what the band usually does. But you know what? That's also one of the reasons why it might be a little lower for me, because I love the pompous Queen sound. This is definitely far from that. So mixing all that together, trying to be fair to it versus what I think of it versus everything else, 8.5 seems a solid place to land. It definitely is a landmark song for the band, so I can't give it that much of a lower mark just because I'm a little sick of it. So 8.5, but unfortunately it does not slide into my top 10 Queen songs or Queen related tracks of all time. As you know, if you've listened to the podcast, 10.5 or higher is the bottom line so far. If you hit 10.5, you have a chance. If you don't, you're not going to make my top 10. They're all 10.5 and 11 at this time. But that will do it for this week, folks. Thanks for sticking around for one of our longest podcasts. I might not make the actual longest, but it probably was the most tracks you've listened to. If you listen to all of them, God bless you. I really do appreciate you. And hopefully you'll come back more. You'll come back for next week. We're getting to a much lesser version of the song. It's Need Your Lovin' Tonight. Also written by John Deacon, but quite a few lesser versions to get through. That's next week, though. If you do like this, hit that like, hit that subscribe. And if you're on the audio side of things, give us those ratings. We really could appreciate the battle for the algorithm. And if you want to help us even further, patreon.com/PLDprojects. Great crew over there, Austin Cadell, Brandon Buckingham. We're going to do some good stuff. I think that'll do it for this week, guys. Stay tuned next week. Next week, this podcast, another Crown Jewels Bites the Dust. But I still need your loving tonight. So come back for next week. Bye now.